Okay, good morning students. Now in this revision class we revise the topics of viscosity and some topics in gravitation. Okay, first we start with viscosity. So what is viscosity means? When there is a relative motion between the different layers of liquid, this viscosity acts between the two layers. So when there is a relative motion between the two different layers of a liquid, and this viscosity acts into play, and this viscosity can be considered as an internal frictional force between the layers of the liquid. And according to Newton, when we consider a flow of liquid like this, different layers like this, the layers, suppose if we consider a surface, on a surface or in a tube like structure, suppose a fluid is flowing inside, a liquid is flowing like this in a tube, the layer which is in contact with the surface will have zero velocity, and slow the velocity of these layers increases as we move away from the surface like this. Okay, that means there is a variation of velocity between layers as we move from the surface which is in contact with the solid surface. So according to Newton, this viscous force is proportional to the area of the surface, and viscous force is also proportional to the velocity gradient dv by dx. Velocity gradient means variation of velocity with the distance. That means if this is small distance dx, if there is a small variation in velocity dv, then that velocity gradient is given by dv by dx. So combining these two equations, we have f is equal to eta a dv by dx. Okay, so this eta is called coefficient of viscosity. Coefficient of viscosity. Okay, therefore coefficient of viscosity eta is equal to f divided by a into dv by dx. So its unit is Newton per meter square, Newton by meter square into meter per second by meter. So this is Newton second per meter square, or this can be written as Pascal second inverse. So this is the unit of coefficient of viscosity, and in this is in SI units, and in CGS units it is expressed as poise. It is expressed as poise. Okay, you have to remember this formula. And again, the shearing force between two different layers of the liquid are inside a liquid or inside a deep liquid, then the shearing force is given by F by A is equal to shearing stress, or F by A is equal to eta, this one, dv by dx. You have to remember this formula also. Whenever they give shearing stress, you have to remember this formula, force per unit area, that equal to eta into dv by dx. And next concept that you have to remember in this viscosity is Stokes formula and terminal velocity. The first one. Now when a spherical body falls in a liquid under gravity, in a liquid of viscosity, coefficient of viscosity eta, it falls with a velocity v, and a spherical body of radius r, then the viscous force experienced by this ball, that means the viscous force experienced by this spherical body, is given by F is equal to 6 pi eta r v, where v is velocity, radius of the sphere, and eta is the coefficient of viscosity of the fluid and in which this particular spherical body is falling. So this is called Stokes' law. You remember this one. And the next one is terminal velocity. Now when a spherical body of radius r falls under gravity in a fluid of coefficient of viscosity eta, and if d is the density or rho is the density or sigma is the density, d is the density of the body and rho is the density of the liquid, and d is the density of the spherical body falls under gravity in a viscous force, in a viscous liquid of coefficient of viscosity eta, then the three forces experienced by it is its weight downwards mg and the buoyant force upwards and viscous force is also upwards. So the sum of the net forces acting on this is W, that is 4 by 3 pi r cube dg, and this buoyant force and viscous force both are acting upwards, that is 6 pi eta rv, and this is 4 by 3 pi r cube rho z. These are the forces. Now at any condition, we first, as it is falling down means it's this force is greater than the sum of these two. So W is equal to net force is W minus FB plus FB. This is the net force acting on that body. So its acceleration of this body is given by this force by mass of the body. So okay. Now as this body falls under gravity, its velocity goes on increasing. If velocity increases, this particular viscous force increases. This particular viscous force increases means this value increases. The term in this bracket term, this value increases. At a particular velocity value, this becomes zero. And in the condition, acceleration is zero and the body moves with uniform velocity, and that velocity is called terminal velocity. Okay? And that terminal velocity is given by W is when these two are equal. So for a particular velocity, what happens is the weight of the body is equal to sum of this buoyant force and viscous force. So in this condition, it acquires a velocity called terminal velocity. So we can substitute like this: 1 by 4 pi 3 r cube dg is equal to 4 by 3 pi r cube rho z plus 6 pi eta rv. So pi will get cancelled in all the terms, r square will get cancelled. So we can write 4 by 3 into r square d minus rho into z is equal to 6 pi, this is no pi, eta v. So this is 2 and this is 3. So we can write it as 2 by 9. R square d minus rho z by v, sorry, by eta. So this is the terminal velocity. You remember this. So terminal velocity of a spherical body in a fluid of coefficient of viscosity eta is given by this one. Okay, I'll write like this. So terminal velocity is equal to 2 by 9 r square d minus rho z by eta. So this is the formula for terminal velocity. So you remember this formula in solving these problems based on viscosity. Now we solve some problems in our book. Okay, now we'll solve the problems in page number 266. Problem number 131. A metal plate of area 400 centimeter square is placed on a glycerin layer of thickness 5 mm, where the coefficient of glycerin is 2 Pascal second. The horizontal force required to move the plate with a velocity 5 meter per second is in Newton. So in this one, given that a metal plate of area 400 centimeter square, and that is 400 into 10 power minus 4 meter square, and a gap thickness of 5 millimeter, that is 5 10 power minus 3 meter, and eta is given as 2 Pascal second inverse, and V is given as 5 centimeter per second, that is 5 into 10 power minus 2 meter per second. Now we have to calculate the force required. So as we know, F is equal to eta A dV by dx. So F is equal to, eta is this one 2, A is 400 10 power minus 4, dV is this one 10 power minus 2 divided by dx is this one. That is 0.8 Newton. Now the next one. If the shearing stress between the horizontal layers of water in a river is 1.5 millinewton per meter square, and eta of water is 1 into 10 to the power minus 3, the velocity gradient is, okay, in this case they are given as shearing stress. As 1.5 milli Newton per meter square, that is 1.5 10 power minus 3 Newton per meter square, and eta is given as 1 into 10 power minus 3 Pascal second, then find dV by dx. Now we have this relation, F is equal to eta A dV by dx. So shearing stress means F by A, that equal to eta dV by dx. So we have to find velocity gradient. So dV by dx equal to, this F by A is given as this one. So 1.5 F by A by 1 by eta, that is F by A is given this one, 1.5 10 power minus 3 by eta is this one, 1 into 10 power minus 3. So that is, that is 1.5 meter, sorry, per second. Now the same one, similar, 133. If a force of 10 Newton is required to draw a rectangular glass plate on the surface of liquid with some velocity, the force needed to draw another glass plate of 3 times length and 2 times width is. Okay, you see, the force required is 10 to draw a rectangular glass plate on the surface of liquid with some velocity. Okay, force needed to draw another glass plate 2-3 times length and 2 times breadth. Suppose if it is a rectangular glass plate, the force required is 10 Newton. Assume that its area is A, that is rectangular glass plate means LB. Now what is the force required if we increase this area as 3L into 2B? That is the right one, because length 3 times and breadth 2 times. Okay, that is 6LB, that means 6A1. So A2 can be taken as 6A1. Now this force, we know the required force required is proportional to A. So F1 by F2 is equal to A1 by A2. Implies 10 by F2 is equal to A by 6A. That is F2 is equal to 60 Newton. Now 135, you see, the velocity of water in a river is 10 kmph near the surface. If the river is of 4 meter deep, the shearing stress between the horizontal layers of water in Newton per meter square, and the eta of water is given as 10 power minus 3 Pascal second. Okay, the velocity of the river velocity of water in a river is 18 km per hour near the surface, and it is 4 meter deep. So given that the top layer of river, top layer of water of the river is, velocity is 18 km per hour. So it is 4 meter deep. That means the velocity at the lowest, so lower surface is, velocity of the last layer, lower layer is 0. Now the velocity gradient dv by dx is 18 convert into meter per second. So 18 into 5 by 18, that is 5 meter per second. So 5 meter per second divided by the distance is 4 meter. So this is the velocity gradient. 1.25. Now We have to calculate the shearing force. As we know, F is equal to eta adv by dx. We have to calculate shearing force, means F by A, that equal to eta dv by dx. So this eta is given as, for water, it is 10 power minus 3. So 10 power minus 3 into this 1.25. So the shearing stress is 1.25 10 power minus 3 Newton per meter square. Now the next one, 136. Two flat plates are separated by a layer of 4 mm thick liquid The upper plate is moved by a force of 400 dynes with a velocity 10 meter per second. If the area of the upper plate is 5 centimeter square, the coefficient of viscosity of the liquid is. So here, two plates are separated by a thin layer of 4 mm. That means thickness or the distance of separation is 4 mm between the two plates. That is 4 into 10 power minus 3 meter. And next one, the velocity is given, we will calculate all the units in centimeter, okay, 4 millimeter, that is 0.4 centimeter, okay, I'll write like this. The upper layer velocity is given as 10 centimeter per second, so that we will calculate in poise. Force required is 400 dyne. And the area of the plate is 5 centimeter square. Now calculate the coefficient of viscosity. Now eta is equal to F divided by A dV by dx. That is 400 by 5 into dV by dx. Velocity is, because the upper layer has a velocity of 10 centimeter per second, the lower layer plate is at rest. So velocity gradient is 10 minus 0, that is 10, and separated by a distance 0.4, that is 40 by 5 into 10 by 4, so this is 4 here, 10 also gets cancelled, 16 by 5, that is 3.2 poise. Now the some problems based on terminal velocity, application of Stokes' law. Now page number 268, problem number 158. Two equal drops of water are falling through air with a steady velocity 10 meter per second, 10 centimeter per second. If the drops combine to form a single drop, then the terminal velocity is, okay? So actually terminal velocity Vt is proportional to radius, square of the radius of the falling body or a drop, okay? First, the velocity, this is the relation between, terminal velocity is proportional to square of the radius of the spherical body. So if two drops are falling with a velocity 10 meter per second, if they combine with to form a big drop, then the terminal velocity become, what is the terminal velocity? So given, suppose if you assume r is the radius of each drop, then the volume of the drop is 4 by 3 pi r cube. So the total, that means two drops, so each drop has a volume of this one, and this 2 into this is the total volume, this equal to volume of the big drop, that is 4 by 3 pi capital R cube, assume like this. So this one and this one cancel, so 2 to the power 1 by 3 into R is equal to capital R. So the radius of the capital big drop is capital R. which is related to the small drop radius as this one. Now if you can write like this, V1 by V2 is equal to R1 by R2. Okay, so V1 is given as 10, so we have to calculate terminal velocity V2 centimeter per second. And R1 is equal to R, R2 is equal to 2 to the power 1 by 3 R. Now substituting this in equation, we get 10 by V2 is equal to R square by 2 to the power 2 by 3 into R square. So we will get cancelled. So implies V2 is equal to 10 into 2 to the power 2 by 3. Sorry, centimeter per second. Now this 163, an air bubble of radius 1 centimeter rises with a constant speed of 3.5 millimeter per second through a liquid density. The coefficient of viscosity of the liquid is, neglect the density of air. Okay. Which one? So an air bubble of radius R 1 centimeter, this one is 163. An air bubble of radius 1 centimeter rises with a constant speed 3.5 millimeter per second, that is 3.5 into 10 to the power minus 3, here it is 10 to the power minus 2 meter. Meter per second. Now the density of the liquid is, that means rho, that equal to 1.75 10 power minus 3 kg per meter cube, and the density of the bubble air d is equal to density of air. So take it as 0, neglected means take it as 0. Now find the coefficient of viscosity. So we have this formula, V is equal to 2 by 9 R square rho minus D into G by eta. So eta is equal to 2 by 9 R square rho minus D into G by V. Okay. This is 2 by 9, 10 to the power minus 4, but squaring it. So this is 1.75 10 cube into 10, take G as 10, and this V as 3.5 10 power minus 3. So this 10 power minus 3 will get cancelled as minus 1, and this minus 1 will cancel. So 2 by 9 into 1.75 into 10 cube by 3.5 means about 6 times, I think. Okay, one like this, 2 by 9, 17.5 10 square by 3.5 means 6 times, 9, 6 means 3 and 2, 4, 4 by 3, 10 square. So if we take G as 9.8, so assume that G is 9.8. Okay. This is 2 by 9, means 10 power minus 4, 1.75 10 cube by 3.5 10 power minus 3 into 9.8. If you take like this, minus 1. 0.6. That is 2 by 9 into 60 into 9.8. Forty into 9.8 by 2. That's 3. This six. 39.2 divided by 3. 13.2. Approximately like this. Okay, these are the models on viscosity and terminal velocity. Now we will discuss some topics, revision of some topics on gravitation. So you know, gravitation, first you have to remember Newton's law. What is Newton's law? Is Newton's law of universal gravitation is the force of gravitational attraction between two bodies is proportional to the product of their masses and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them and acts along the line joining the two points. Suppose if we consider this as M1, first body M1, second body M2, separated by a distance like this. Then the gravitational force of attraction between them, F, is equal to proportional to M1, M2 by R square. So that is F equal to G M1, M2 by R square. And this is the magnitude of the force, and the direction of the force acts along the line joining these two point masses are these two masses like this. Okay, that means this body attracts this body and this body attracts this body. Okay, so this is the, and this G is called universal gravitational constant and its value is 6.67 Newton meter square per kg square. This is the unit of this G, 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11 Newton meter square per kg square. So this is Newton's law. And you have to, whenever the problems come across between two bodies, you have to assume that this force acts along the line joining, straight line joining these two points. Okay. And next, Kepler's laws. Kepler's first law is regarding the orbits. So every planet revolves around the Sun in an elliptical orbit with the Sun being at one of its foci. And second law is the radius vector joining the Sun and the planet sweeps out equal areas in equal intervals of time. That is, its aerial velocity is constant. That is, dA by dt is constant. Okay. Or half r square d theta by dt is constant. Okay. And third one, the time period of revolution of a planet around the Sun is the radius of the, or the distance between the Sun and the planet are related by this third law. Square of time period of revolution of a planet around the Sun is proportional to the major axis, semi-major, cube of the semi-major axis of the elliptical orbit. But we can take it as mean distance from the planet and Sun. Okay, so we can write it as t square is proportional to r cube also. So these are the Kepler's laws. And we know that the acceleration produced in a body due to the earth gravitational field, we call it as acceleration due to gravity, and it is small g. So small g is acceleration due to gravity, means the acceleration produced in a body when it moves under the gravitational force of the earth or gravitation force of the planet. So g is equal to acceleration due to gravity, and capital G as universal gravitational constant. Okay, the relation between the small g and capital G is small g is equal to capital Gm by r square, where m is the mass of the planet and r is the radius of the planet. You have to remember this formula. Okay, so the acceleration due to gravity on a particular planet is equal to g mass of the planet by radius of the planet. So for any planet we can apply this formula. Okay, and another one is, suppose if two point masses are separated by, suppose this is m1 and m2, separated by a distance d like this. So the gravitational field strength, or the, suppose if we assume a unit mass kept at a particular point, or a unit mass is kept at a distance, where should be a unit mass is placed so that the gravitational force on that particular unit mass is zero. Means, suppose if we place at a distance x from the m1, suppose here, suppose if we place a unit mass, that means 1 kg mass, then this force on this 1 kg mass is 0, means the force of attraction due to this m1 and force of attraction due to m2 are balance each other. That means we can write this as g m1 into 1 by x square is equal to this one, g m2 into 1 by this distance is d minus x. So d minus x whole square. So g will get cancelled. So m1 by x square is equal to m2 by d minus x whole square, implies d minus x by x whole square is equal to m2 by m1. From this we can write d minus x by x equal to m2 by m1 under root. So this is d by x minus 1 equal to square root of m2 by m1. So d by x equal to square root of m2 by m1 plus 1. So x equal to d divided by square root of m2 by m1 plus 1. This is the relation. Okay. So if you remember this formula, if you forget this formula, you assume this condition. Okay. So this is the distance of this point from mass m1. You have to remember like that. Now some problems are based on these two topics, based on these concepts. Now in this one, page number 89. Okay. Now we'll go with problem number 2. Two metal spheres of radius r kept in contact with each other. If d is the density of the metal spheres, then the gravitational force between those spheres is proportional to. So okay. Two metal spheres of radius r kept in contact like this, r and r, okay, and d is the density of these two one. Now the gravitational force of attraction between them is proportional to, so we have to calculate f. So as we know, f equal to g m1 m2 by r square, so we are asking only proportionality, so f is proportional to m1 m2 by r square. So but mass we can write it as 4 by 3 pi r cube density, that means volume into density, and for this also 4 by 3 pi r cube density whole divided by the distance between them is 2 r whole square. So again this become 4 r square. So all these are constants, so f is proportional to r cube, r cube that is r power 6 by r square into d square, that is r power 4 into d square. So the gravitational force of attraction is proportional to r power 4 and d square. Now the third one, three particles of mass m, each are kept at the three vertices of an equilateral triangle of side L. The resultant gravitational force acting on each particle is, okay, so given that three particles each of mass m are kept at the three vertices of an equilateral triangle of side L, then the resultant gravitational force on each of them. So suppose if we consider this one, okay, this particular mass m attracts this particular mass m in this direction, and this one attracts in this direction. Okay. So suppose if we consider this particular mass, the two forces acting on this mass are this one and this one in these directions. So this force, that means if you consider this as F1 and this as F2, so F1 is equal to F2 as this distance is same and mass is same. So this is equal to GMM by L square, that is GM square by L square. But the resultant force by parallelogram law is F is equal to F1 square plus F2 square plus 2 f1 f2 cos theta under root. But here it is an equilateral triangle, this angle is 60 degree. So we are substituting this gm square by l square plus gm square by l square plus 2 gm square by l square. Sorry, whole square. This is also whole square. Whole square into cos 60. Cos 60 is half under root. So total it is 3. So root 3 into gm square by l square. Fourth one, four particles of masses m, 2m, 3m, 4m are placed at the corners of a square of side length L, A. The gravitational force on the particle of mass m placed at the center of the square. So given like this. Four particles of mass m, 2m, 3m, 4m. Now a particle of mass m is placed at the center of the square. Then the gravitational force acting on this mass m is each of side A. Now this particular body is attracted by this mass in this direction. This mass is in this direction, and this 3m mass is in this direction, m mass is in this direction. Now these two are in same straight line, these two are in same straight line but opposite directions. So all the distances are equal to, actually this is the diagonal, that is root 2a, and half of the diagonal is root 2a by 2, that is a by root 2. So in every case we have to consider this r is equal to a by root 2. Okay, now the force, now we consider this as f1, f3, f2, f4. So f1 and f3. So f1 is equal to gm square by a square, that is 2 into 2. A square by 2, that is 2gm square by a square, and f3 is this one, gm 3m by a square by 2, that is 2 3gm square by a square. Okay, as these two are in opposite directions, but the magnitude of f3 is greater than f1, so the resultant of these two, so fr1, resultant of 1 3 is this minus this, f3 minus f1, that is 2gm square by a square into 3 minus 1, that is 4gm square by a square. Now consider these two, f2 and f4. So f2 is equal to gm 2m by a square by 2, that is 2gm square into 2 by a square. Now f4 is these two, gm 4m by a square by 2, that is 2gm square into 4 by a square. Now these two are opposite directions, the resultant is f4 minus f2. So f resultant of 4 and 2 is f4 minus f2. So taking common terms and what you can see, this 2gm square by a square is common, so 2gm square by a square into 4 minus 2, that is again 4gm square by a square. Now the resultant of these two is in this direction, this is f13 and this is f24. Now these two are again perpendicular to each other like this, so the resultant force F equal to square root of f13 square plus f24 square, that is square root of, both those two are equal, So we can directly write it as square root 2 into 4 gm square by a square. Now page number 91 and problem number 28. Two particles each of mass m are placed at A and C such that AB and BC equal to L. The gravitational force on a third particle of same mass placed at D at a distance L on the perpendicular bisector line of AC. Okay. So given that two particles of mass m are placed at A and C such that another midpoint is B. That is, this is L and this is L. Given that AB is equal to BC is equal to L. Now, a third particle of same mass is placed at a distance D, L on the perpendicular bisector. So, the perpendicular bisector line is this. So, at a point D, where another mass M is placed. Okay. Now, the force, gravitational force acting on this particle mass M at D. Now, if you consider this is the line joining these two points and this is the line joining these two points. So, the force of attraction on this particle due to this particle is in this direction. Force of attraction due to particle at A on this one is in this direction. Okay. Now, these two are at right angle. This is right angle. Now, this particular particle force, suppose if you consider this as F1, this is F2. Then F1 is equal to F. Now, if this is L and this is also L because perpendicular bisector line L at a distance. So, this becomes root 2L and this is also root 2L. Okay. So, F1 is equal to GMM by R square. That means 2L square. So, F2 is also equal to the same GM, that is gm square by 2l square, and this is also equal to gm square by 2l because these two are at same distance. Now, the resultant of these two, because these two are in these directions, so resultant force F is equal to square root of F1 square plus F2 square plus actually 2F1 F2 cos theta, as theta is 90, we are neglecting this term. So, this is square root of 2 into this one. Gm square by L square. But this force acts along this direction by parallelogram law. Okay. So, this is the resultant force. So, the answer is the force on this particle at D has a magnitude square root 2 dm gm square by L square along AD, BD direction. Now, the next one. Now, page number 93, problem number 41. Masses 2 kg and 8 kg are 18 centimeter apart. The point where the gravitational field due to them is 0. Okay. So masses 2 kg and 8 kg are 18 centimeter apart. The point where the gravitational field due to them is zero. So assume that that is at a distance x from 2 and this distance is 18 minus x. Okay. So here we have to assume a unit mass. That means you have to assume 1 kg mass here. Then that force acting on this point is zero. So we can directly write like this. So g into 2 by x square equal to g into 8 by 18 minus x whole square, that is 4. So 1 by x square equal to 4 by 18 minus x whole square, or we can write 1 by x equal to 2 by 18 minus x. So 18 minus x equal to 2x, 18 equal to 3x, x equal to 6. So 6 centimeter from 2 kg mass, or we can directly apply the formula x equal to d divided by square root of m2 by m1 plus 1. Here the distance is from m1. So x is equal to 18 divided by square root of 8 divided by 2 plus 1. That is 18 by 4. Square root of 2 is 2. 2 plus 1. That is 18 by 3, 6. By any method we can solve. If we remember this one, you okay. If you forget this, you can apply this. Now, the 43. Three equal masses M are placed at the three vertices of an equilateral triangle of side A. The gravitational force exerted by this system on another particle of mass M placed at the midpoint of a side. Once again. Three equal masses M are kept at the three vertices of an equilateral triangle of side A. The gravitational force exerted by the system on another particle of mass M placed at the midpoint of a side. So first, initially there are three masses M, each same mass, are at the vertices of an equilateral triangle M, and the side of the triangle is A. Now another mass is placed at the center of any of this side. Suppose assume here center of this one, another mass M, then the gravitational force experienced by this mass, which is kept at the center of this side. Okay. Now, this force exert a force in this direction, and this mass exert in this direction, and this mass exert the force in this direction. Okay. So, this force is equal to these two. So, g m square by a by 2 whole square, and this is also g m square by a by 2 whole square. Okay, these two are equal and opposite, so they will get cancel each other. So the net force along this direction is zero. So the resultant is only this one, which is it. So now if this is a by 2, this distance is a by 2. If this is a and this is a by 2, this is root 3 a by 2. Now this force is resultant force F equal to g m square by root 3 a by 2 whole square. That is 2 g m square by 3 a square. 4 g m square by 3 a square. Now this 95. Now page number 95, problem number 67. Three spherical balls of mass 1 kg, 2 kg, 3 kg are placed at the corners of an equilateral triangle of side 1 meter. The magnitude of gravitational force exerted by 2 kg, 3 kg masses on 1 kg mass. So similar one. So three masses are given. So this is 1 kg, assume like this, 1 kg, 2 kg and 3 kg. Each side 1 meter. Now the net force acting on this particular 1 kg mass. Okay. Now this 1 kg mass is attracted by this 2 kg mass in this direction, this 3 kg mass in this direction. So the net force acting on this is in these two directions. Okay. This force is F1. If you consider this as F2, then F1 is equal to G into 2 into 1 by 1 square. That is 2g, and F2 is equal to g into 3 into 1 by 1 square, that is 3g. So this is one and this one. Now the resultant of these two, F is equal to, as this equilateral triangle, this angle is 60 degrees. That means F1 and F2 are acting along 60 degree orientation. So square root of F1 square, F2 square plus 2F1 F2 cos 60, that is square root of 2g whole square plus 3g whole square plus 2 into 2g 3g into 1 by 2. So we will get cancel. This is 4g square plus 9g square plus 6g square, total under root, that is 990. Square root of 19g square, that is square root of 19 into g. So this is the resultant force acting on this 1 kg mass. Now page number 99, 108. Particles each of mass m are placed along x axis at x equal to 1, x equal to 2, x equal to 4, x equal to 8, etc. to infinity. The gravitational field strength at the origin due to this system of particles is, that means these particles along x equal to 1, x equal to 2, x equal to 4, x equal to 8, etc. So everyone is of mass m like this. Okay, now if a unit mass is kept at O, origin, then the force acting on this unit mass is gravitational field strength, we have to calculate. Okay, now force due to this one is gm by x square, that is 1 square. And the next one, because all these forces are acting along x axis, so we can directly sum up. So resultant force F equal to gm by r square. Here gm by unit mass 2 square plus gm by 4 square plus gm by 8 square plus etc. So we can take it as common 8, gm into 1 by 1 square, that is 1, plus 1 by 2 square plus 1 by 4 square plus 1 by 8 square plus etc. So we can write it as gm into 1 plus 1 by 2 square, that is 2 to the power 0, plus 1 by 4 can be written as 2 square to the power 4, 2 to the power 4 plus 1 by 2 cube, that is 2 to the power 6, so etc. Now this is in geometric progression and common ratio is 1 by 2 square. So the sum of infinite numbers in geometric progression is a by 1 minus r. If this is when r is less than 1. So you can write it as common. First term is 1 by 1 minus common ratio is 1 by 2 square, that is 1 by 4, where r is equal to 1 by 2 square, that is 1 by 4. So this is a by, so that is 1 divided by 1 minus 1 by 3 by 4, that is 4 by 3. Now here substituting, so f is equal to 4 gm by 3. Okay.